In ancient Egypt, agricultural land along the Nile was divided into square plots, and they were distributed evenly among the citizens. Each year, the citizens used to pay the king rent, or taxes, to use these plots. But there was a problem. The Nile was known to flood annually, damaging in the process portions of some people's land and making them unusable. So to keep things fair, after each flood, the king used to send his surveyors, known as rope stretchers, or people who stretched ropes with knots, to measure the area of the damaged land and reduce taxes accordingly. And from this practice, the art of geometry was born. This story is according to Herodotus, the ancient Greek historian. Whether or not it is true, we have no evidence, but we have evidence that the ancient Egyptians were one of the earliest people to ever study geometry. We know this from a number of papyri that somehow have survived the ravages of time and made it through the millennia to our present day. Most importantly, the Ahmes, or the Rhine Papyrus, a 3,500-year-old document that contains problems and solutions for calculating areas of different geometric fields. But how is all of this related to calculus? See, in the last video, we talked about how the two main processes of calculus are cutting and stitching. And the history of calculus is the history of the evolution of these cutting and stitching processes, which we can divide into five main methods. And the first method, dissection, is what is believed to have been used by the ancient Egyptians to calculate areas and volumes of different shapes. So let's see this method in action. We start with the rectangle. The ancient Egyptians took it for granted that the area of the rectangle is its height times its width. Although there is no cutting and stitching involved in this example, the rectangle is an important shape for the dissection method, as we will soon see. It's worth noting that the Ahmes Papyrus doesn't state problems in terms of variables. It rather states them in terms of specific numbers. And the numbers used for this rectangle is a height of 2 khet, which is an ancient Egyptian unit, and a width of 10. And we can actually see this when we zoom into the papyrus, where this is the symbol for the number 2, which is basically two vertical bars. This is the symbol for the number 10, and these are the symbols for khet. Another shape mentioned in the papyrus is a triangle with a height of 10 khet and a base of 4. The ancient Egyptians used the same formula we use today to calculate the area of the triangle, which is its height times half its base. But how did the ancient Egyptians come up with this formula? The Ahmes Papyrus doesn't explain this, but it offers a hint. It talks about transforming the triangle into a rectangle. And an easy way to do so, which is believed to have been used by the ancient Egyptians, is the dissection method, where we cut the triangle in half and then rearrange and stitch the pieces back together to form the rectangle, which the ancient Egyptians already knew how to calculate its area, obtaining the formula for the area of the triangle. What we just saw is our first step on our calculus journey, as this simple act of cutting would evolve over the millennia, leading to differential calculus, and the simple act of stitching would evolve, leading to integral calculus. Another shape mentioned in the papyrus is a trapezoid, which again it talks about transforming it into a rectangle, which we can achieve using the dissection method. It is believed that the ancient Egyptians used the dissection method to calculate areas and volumes of different shapes, and although they studied the circle, their formula for the area of the circle was an approximate and not an exact one, and for the most part, their geometry was rectilinear, meaning the shapes they studied were straight-edged shapes. The same was also true of the geometry of other ancient civilizations, like Babylonia, India, and China. Curvilinear geometry, or geometry of curved shapes, had to wait for another civilization, ancient Greece. The ancient Greeks didn't study curves for practical purposes. They studied them for intellectual ones. But they didn't have many curves to study. They had only around 12 curves. Still, there were 11 more than what was known at the time. You may be wondering, but how come they only had around 12 curves? Aren't curves everywhere in nature? See, curves in nature don't have specific mathematical definition, and therefore, it is not possible to study them mathematically. Compare this to the circle, for example, which is defined as the shape that consists of all the points in a plane that are equidistant from a given point. Similarly, all the other curves that were studied in ancient Greece have clear mathematical definitions. Some of them are defined as the curves that are obtained by slicing solid geometric figures, like a cone, which we will talk about soon, or a torus. Others are defined as the curves that are obtained by some form of mechanical motion, and they are called mechanical curves. The ancient Greeks divided their curves into three ranks based on what they thought of as the naturalness of the curves. The first rank contains the most natural of them all, the circle. The second rank, of medium naturalness, contains the ellipse, parabola, and hyperbola. The third rank, the least natural, contains all the other curves. They focused most of their attention on the top two ranks, which are collectively known as the conic sections, or the curves that are obtained by slicing a cone at different angles. But how did the ancient Greeks study those curves? They did so by using the second method on our list, the method of exhaustion. The method of exhaustion is basically taking the cutting and stitching processes to the extreme. It originated with Antiphon in the 5th century BC when he was working on the area of the circle. Antiphon started by inscribing a polygon inside the circle. Now, finding the area of a polygon is easy, as we can cut it into triangles and then sum up the areas of these triangles. Clearly, there is a difference between the area of the polygon and the area of the circle. But Antiphon argued that if we double the number of the sides of the polygon, and then double the number of the sides of that polygon, and kept going on, eventually we use up or exhaust the circle. And although he was vague about it, it seems that he meant that the area of an infinite-sided polygon would equal the area of the circle. But how can we find the area of an infinite-sided polygon? Antiphon didn't provide an answer for this question, but his way of thinking opened up the door to eventually arrive at a solution for the area of the circle. So let's see how. What we want to do is to stitch or integrate an infinite number of infinitesimal triangles. Now, we can't do this directly, and we need to find a workaround. So let's start with a simpler polygon, say a hexagon, or more accurately, a regular hexagon, where all the sides are equal, and see if we can find any pattern. The hexagon is made up of 6 triangles, and the area of one triangle is, as we saw earlier, its height times half its base, which we can rewrite as half HB. Since we have 6 triangles, then the area of the hexagon is half HB times 6. Now, H is the height of the triangle, but it is also the distance between the side of the hexagon and its center, which is known as the apothem of the polygon, and we will write it for short as A. B is the base of the triangle. B times 6 is the combination of the bases of all 6 triangles, which is also the perimeter of the hexagon, and we will write it for short as P. Therefore, the area of a regular hexagon, or any regular polygon, is half its apothem times its perimeter. Now, when we double the number of the sides of the polygon, we notice that its apothem gets closer to the radius of the circle, and its perimeter gets closer to the circumference. And when we keep doubling, they keep getting closer and closer. This suggests that at infinity, the apothem would line up with the radius of the circle, and the perimeter would line up with the circumference. Therefore, the area of an infinite-sided polygon, or the area of the circle, is half the radius times the circumference. And when it was discovered later that the circumference is equal to 2 pi r, with basic simplification we obtained the familiar formula for the area of the circle, pi r squared. On the one hand, this method is intuitive, and it actually gives the correct result. On the other hand, it is based on shaky logic, as it uses infinity and infinitesimals, and therefore it was rejected by the ancient Greeks, particularly after Zeno, a contemporary of Antiphon, devised his famous paradoxes that showed the absurdity of dealing with infinities and infinitesimals. In fact, infinity became a taboo for the ancient Greeks, and they developed what came to be known as the horror of the infinite. So the method of Antiphon had to be modified for it to be accepted by the ancient Greeks. This was accomplished by Eudoxus and later improved by Archimedes. Eudoxus and Archimedes used solid logical arguments to show that our polygon need not go all the way to infinity for us to be able to make assertions about the area of the circle. I'll talk more about their arguments in a later video in the series, the regularization of calculus, as they are a precursor to the modern idea of the limit. Archimedes then used this method of exhaustion, or the modified version of it, to study the areas of the ellipse, parabola, and Archimedean spiral, and the volume of the paraboloid, and his proudest work, the volume of the sphere. But the method of exhaustion has a massive drawback. It is extremely difficult to implement. See, with the circle, it wasn't that difficult, as all what we had to do is to keep doubling the number of the sides of the polygon. But as the curves get more and more complex, knowing how to cut and stitch them back becomes increasingly more difficult. That's why Archimedes had another method, one based on the taboo, on infinitesimals, that he used first to discover the formulas of the areas and the volumes of the shapes that he was studying, and then used the method of exhaustion to prove these formulas. Unfortunately, Archimedes' infinitesimal method was lost, only to be rediscovered in 1906, long after the discovery of calculus. Interestingly, it is similar to the third method on our list, the method of indivisibles, which was discovered over 2000 years after the method of exhaustion, and only a few decades before the discovery of calculus. So what caused this massive gap? And what sparked this explosive development in the 17th century that culminated in the discovery of calculus? This is an important chapter in the history of calculus, and it is the topic of our next video. See you then.